you know, you should never clap at the start because it might not actually deserve it. So, yeah, it's good to be with you guys. It was cool. I'm grateful for Craig inviting me to come. And I knew that Craig was here and John and Jordan were here, but I also discovered in first service, Stephen Stewart was here, Jeff Shard was here, guys who are new friends of mine, you know, on staff there at Harvest. If there's anybody else that I'm forgetting who's on Harvest staff, maybe the guys in the tech booth back there, my apologies for forgetting you. But I think you got an all-star staff here, an all-star group. I hope that you guys appreciate what they do for you, because they're good guys. Yeah. But I do have to confess, this isn't my favorite church in Aurora. It's about 6 miles from here. There's a guy named Bob Stevenson, who pastors the Village Baptist Church of Aurora. And Bob Stevenson is married to a young woman named Becky Vanlaningham Stevenson. And so, yeah, my son-in-law pastors a church in Aurora here as well. I pray for them more than I pray for you, but I still like you guys. Just want you to know that. All right. So let's take our Bibles. We're going to go to Hebrews chapter 11. As Craig mentioned, we're kicking off a new series today. But while you're turning there, I just want to tell you a story about from when I was a kid in our family. In about 1965, our family bought a 1964 Plymouth Fury II station wagon. And I thought it was a pretty nice car. It was much nicer than the 1952 Plymouth that we just got rid of, which was a horrible, awful, nasty car. It just was awful. We had it forever. It was a pretty nice car. For reasons that I can't explain, because our family normally kept cars for a long time, in 1969, we bought a 1968 Dodge Monaco station wagon. Now, the Dodge Monaco station wagon was about the size of Montana. The thing was huge, and it was in every regard was a better car than the Plymouth Fury II. It had a bigger engine. It had better acceleration. And I know that because I got a ticket one time driving it when I was in college. And It had a better ride, it had better gas mileage, it had a better interior, it was better looking. Like I said, it had more power. We had a trailer, our family did, and so we needed a big, strong V8 to be able to pull the trailer really well, and this thing did it without even thinking about it. This car, the Dodge Monaco, was better in every regard to the Plymouth Fury station wagon. And the reason why I'm telling you that is because in the book of Hebrews, one of the primary themes in the book of Hebrews is that Jesus is better than anything else out there. Specifically in the context of what's being discussed in Hebrews, the idea is that Jesus and Judaism with Jesus is vastly superior to Judaism without Jesus. And the reason why I'm talking about Judaism is because Jewish people come to faith in Christ all the time. We oftentimes will call them Messianic Jews. That's sort of the name for them. This was a group of Jewish people, most all of whom had come to Christ by faith and found salvation. The problem is that there was a group of people within the church who had not yet actually come all the way to Christ. And so the book of Hebrews is written to them to do that, to come all the way to faith in Jesus, to embrace him altogether. And apparently, as we read through the book, those people who had not yet embraced Christ, who were still associated with this Messianic Jewish group, however, were apparently, many of them, starting to think about going back to Judaism without Jesus. And that would be a step backwards. That would be a step from the superior back to the inferior. And so the writer writes what he does in Hebrews to say that, number one, Jesus is the final revelation of God. You need to hang on to him. And number two, don't go back to Judaism. Come all the way to Jesus, because some of them hadn't. Now, we're going to pop up a little chart here that just sort of shows you some of the different themes that are going on in Hebrews. These people, some of them, many of them, who had not come all the way to Christ, were still fascinated with the imperfect and that which is inferior. In the book of Hebrews, the inferior things include angels as over against the Son of God. The angels are you see angels a lot in the Old Testament, right? You guys still know that. Angels are all over the place in the Old Testament. But now that which is perfect and superior is the Son. He's come. And the Son has brought the final revelation about God the Father. In the Old Testament, you have the Old Testament priesthood. But we know that Jesus is the high priest, the supreme and the superior high priest. We also know that in the Old Testament, we have the law. But the book of Hebrews says that the law of Moses didn't spiritually perfect or save anybody. But Jesus does. Jesus makes perfect. You have the fascination still that was going on with the Old Covenant, the Law of Moses. We know that the New Covenant in Jesus has come, and so the Old Covenant is obsolete. There are people who were still fascinated with the tabernacle and the temple and the sacrifices, but they needed to come all the way to Jesus. Jesus is the one who died, and his sacrifice was actually applied and utilized and recognized in the heavenly tabernacle before God. And so the people who are part of this group who were thinking about going back to Judaism without Jesus are people who were still fascinated with angels, the Old Testament priesthood, the law, the Old Covenant, the temple and tabernacle. But the writer of Hebrews says those things are imperfect and inferior, and you need to go all the way to Jesus, the Messiah. And so what he does then is he begins to discuss what it means to have faith in the Messiah. And here I'd like it if you would take a look at Hebrews chapter 10, to sort of as we sort of get the context here, starting at verse 35. Verse 35. It says, "Therefore, do not throw away your confidence, which has a great reward. For you have need of endurance, so that when you have done the will of God, you may receive what is promised. For yet a little while, and the coming one will come and will not delay, but my righteous one shall live by faith. And if he shrinks back, my soul has no pleasure in him. But we're not of those who shrink back and are destroyed, but of those who have faith and preserve their souls." But I'm here to tell you, there's five passages in Hebrews that are written specifically for these people who looked like they were going to shrink back to destruction. They weren't going to go all the way to Jesus like most of the people in this group had. And so they were a little bit iffy about Christ at this point. And the writer of Hebrews says, no, Jesus is the superior one, the final one, and all that comes before is obsolete. One other spot I want to go to, take a look at the end of chapter 11 and verse 39. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 39. It says, "And all these," referring to the heroes of faith, and you know what you find with the heroes of faith? You find that they left something that was inferior to follow what God wanted them to do, which was superior. Abram left Ur of the Chaldees. Moses left the pleasures of Egypt to follow God. And almost everybody in chapter 11, by the way, also, if they could have, they would have had reason to go back to the old thing. Then they would have missed out on the astonishing stuff that God had for them. And so these heroes of the faith are written to be able to help encourage those who were part of this messianic group, but were getting soft on Jesus and were thinking about going back without him. This was written to say, no. The very heroes of the faith in the Old Testament, the Jewish heroes, they're the ones who had faith, and they kept going. Look at verse 39. And all these, though commended through their faith, did not receive what was promised, since God had provided something better for us, that apart from us, they should not be made perfect. And so all the heroes of the faith were promised amazing things by God, but virtually all of them did not receive those in this life, and yet they didn't abandon God. Now, all of that is just a setup, basically, for what we're going to be looking at in chapter 11, verses 1 through 3. What we find here is that the writer of Hebrews, by the way, the writer of Hebrews, we don't know who the writer of Hebrews is. And scholars, who tend to be sort of a snotty bunch, have decided rather than write, when they're writing all of their erudite, enlightened stuff, rather than writing the writer of the book of Hebrews a million times, because we can say, you know, about Paul's epistles, we can say, well, Paul says, or Matthew says. We have to say the writer of the book of Hebrews because we don't know who it is. So scholars have given him a name. It's the German word for author, Autor. Autor. I want you to say Autor just once when I point to you, okay? Ready? Autor. Well, let's do it again. Ready? Autor. Now you all know German. That's very cool. Theological German at that. So they call him Autor. I think that's stupid. Let's call him Bill Bob, okay? We'll just call him Bill Bob. So here's what Bill Bob says about what faith is. Faith, persevering faith. If you need faith, if we are of those who have real faith, and if you don't have real faith, you shrink back to destruction, then what's real faith? And so he's going to tell us real faith has three components here, three elements. The first, verse 1. That persevering faith, true faith in Christ that perseveres also, anticipates God's blessings. Take a look at verse 1. Now, faith, what is faith? Faith is reliance upon God and what he says. For us, it's faith in Christ for salvation, that God himself has provided on our behalf. It can also be faith is believing Scripture. Okay, it's believing Scripture as well. And there's some other aspects of this. But he says, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. The word assurance in the ESV probably is not the best translation. It's one of the few places where the ESV probably doesn't quite have it right. The word assurance was almost always, virtually always used in the ancient world with the idea of referring to that which is real. The true essence, the real essence or the real substance of something. And in fact, the King James translates this, that faith is the substance of things hoped for. And so I think that that's probably the better idea here. Just for a moment, go back to Hebrews chapter 1. The same word for that the ESV translates assurance that probably should be translated maybe with a word like reality or essence. So faith is the essence or faith is the reality of things hoped for. That same word is used in Hebrews 1:3 for Jesus. Take a look at Hebrews 1:3. It says, he, referring to Jesus, is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature. That's the same word as assurance or reality or substance in chapter 11, verse 1. I think we could actually say in Hebrews 1:3 that Jesus is the exact imprint of how God really is, or Jesus is the exact reflection of the reality of God. It's something like that is probably the sense. And so I think that the idea in verse 1 is that faith is the substance, it's the reality of things hoped for. Now, let me talk about the things hoped for, and then we're going to come back to what faith does here. What are the things that we hope for? Well, those of us who have faith hope for and have hope in the stuff in the future, the rapture of the church, the second coming of Christ, the establishment of the kingdom of God on earth. You guys understand that the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven, starts in heaven, but it comes to earth as a literal geopolitical entity, right? And then the eternal state. These are all things that are future to us, and faith connects us with that. So let me unpack this just a little bit. I want you to notice here, when it says that faith is the substance or the essence or faith is the reality of things hoped for, we have to spin that a little way. We have to nuance that. My faith does not equal the second coming of Christ. My faith does not equal the coming kingdom of God in the future, or the judgment of the nations, or the eternal state. My faith does not equal that. So what does my faith do? How is that functioning here? And to answer that, look at verse 3. Verse 3, and we're going to come back to verse 3 in just a second. Verse 3 says, by faith we understand that the universe was created by God. We're going to stop there. Notice that in verse 3, faith does something. In verse 3, faith helps us understand. Faith does something. As you read through the heroes of the faith did something in those people. And here's what it does for us. Faith enables us to lay hold of the future hoped in coming realities that are promised us from God. Faith is the thing that connects us to those things. That's what faith does. And so faith does not equal the second coming, but it's faith that lays hold of the coming second coming and all the beautiful future things that we have. Now, the world looks at us and thinks that we're really stupid when it comes to our faith. H.L. Mencken, who was an American literary scholar and satirist, he died in 1956, and by the way, since he died in 56, now he knows better, defined faith as, quote, illogical belief in the occurrence of the impossible. People look at us and they think, well, you guys are just stupid. I'm sorry, people don't like the word stupid. People look at us and think we're very foolish. They think that we believe in nothing. I'm here to tell you that's not the case. We do have faith. Our faith does not create the realities that we await. Our faith connects us with those realities. And even if I never believed, even if I never had faith, that does not change. That someday there will be a rapture of the church. There will be a second coming. There will be a kingdom on the earth. There will be a judgment of the nations. There will be an eternal state. It is not changed by whether or not I have faith. Those things are facts. Now, how do we know those facts? We know them from the Word. We're going to talk about that in just a second. There's two ways that you can know truth about God. One of them is from the Word, and the other is from creation. Now, what creation tells us about spiritual truth is far inferior to what we have in Scripture. Scripture is the final, the best, the most detailed. It's the thing that's authoritative, that we are responsible for. It's infallible. It's inspired. It's inerrant. But creation tells us a lot about God as well, more than we think. We'll get to that in a bit, right? Now, he goes on then. Oh, I just want to tell you another story, too. About 3 weeks ago or 4 weeks ago, there's a pair of magicians called Penn and Teller. And I don't know if you guys have ever heard of them. I like magic stuff. I mean, I don't do magic, but I just think it's cool to watch. And they have a magic show, and they actually came to a theater in Waukegan. About 3 weeks ago, my wife and I went. She bought the tickets, by the way. She just spends money like crazy. Actually, that's not true. I'm the one who does that. If either of us do that, that's me. But we went. It was very interesting. Penn Jillette was talking about the nature of magic and all this stuff. And he said, magic is not faith in stuff that doesn't exist. And then he said, that's religion. Religion is faith in that which isn't true. Faith in that which can't be proven. Faith in that which doesn't exist. And I thought, he has it all wrong. He has it absolutely all wrong. God has promised us glorious future things that are facts. Okay? So also, though, there's another aspect of this here in chapter, in verse 1 as well. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for and the conviction of things not seen. The word conviction, yet again, probably would be better translated by the word proof. The word was actually used in the ancient world for evidence that was reached after careful thought and analysis and deliberation and discussion. And so faith, our faith, is not itself the proof of some glorious things. Our faith is that which helps us see the reality of those things. It is not itself that reality, but it helps us to see that the reality is true, like we see in verse 3. Now, what does it help us see? It helps us see things that are not seen. Okay, so faith is the reality of things hoped for, the proof or the evidence of things not seen. So what are the things not seen? Well, we've talked about the things that are hoped for. But what are the things that are not seen? Here's what's not seen. We don't see the sovereignty of God at work right now in the present. We don't see Jesus currently resurrected and glorified, ascended into heaven, sitting on the right hand of God the Father, praying for us right now. We don't see that right now. That's just two things. Those things are happening right now. But our faith enables us to see the proof of those things and to believe those things. Now, as we already mentioned, the proof of that is found in the Word of God. If you got your Bible here, just hold it up. Hold it up. That's the proof. That's the evidence. You have it there. Faith enables us to see that that stuff is true. Now, I just want to pop something up here. Non-Christians see the same stuff in Scripture that we do. They can read Scripture and see what we see, but they don't believe it. They can look at creation and see the same things we see and reject it. Romans 1 says they reject it. So I just wanted, this is for something fun to do. We're gonna pop up a painting here, painted by an artist named Bev Doolittle. Bev Doolittle lives in California. And I like this painting. There's a First Nations person there who's watching guard on behalf of his village. It's a cool painting. I love the landscape in the background, the mountains and stuff. How many of you don't see the wolf? Raise your hand. Now, my guess is there's at least 20 of you who don't see the wolf, and you're too embarrassed to raise your hand. Do you guys see the wolf? By the way, Craig gave me this really cool laser pointer. I think I'm going to take it home. There's an ear, top of the head, another ear, side of the head. Here's an eye. Here's an eye. You have the snout and nose down here. Do you guys see it now?
Yeah.
Yeah, people are going to go, oh, see, I used to use this in a different class, in a class at Moody, and most of the students, they never got it. It's, you know, it's just a comment about Moody students. Actually, most of them could see it. See, though, here's the thing. It requires Gnostic enlightenment to be able to see the wolf. Not really. But a lot of people don't see it for a while. And when you do see it, you kind of go, oh, do you guys remember how a number of years ago, like 10, 15 years ago, there was this fad came out where people would draw these sort of geometric shapes on a page, and if you held it in front of your eyes just a little bit, let your eyes go out of focus slightly, then you could see an image. Anybody ever do that? I used to do that too. I tried anyway. About 3/4 of the time, I couldn't ever see the thing. I don't think that's actually any reflection on my character. But I couldn't really see the thing. But it's kind of like that. When non-Christians look at the world, they don't see stuff that we see. And we see it precisely because the Word of God says it, and we believe the Word of God. The Word of God is the proof and the evidence of all this amazing stuff that's present for us now, and it says that God created the universe. So, the first aspect of true saving faith is that it perseveres and it anticipates God's blessings. There's the great things coming to us that God has promised, and we have to wait and believe and trust. Here's the second component of true saving faith, and that is a persevering faith receives God's approval. Verse 2. It says in verse 2, for by it, that is by faith, the people of old received their commendation. Take a look at verse 4. The word commendation's all over the place in chapter 11. By faith, Abel offered to God a more acceptable sacrifice than Cain, through which he was commended as righteous, God commending him by accepting his gifts. Take a look at verse 5. By faith, Enoch was taken up so that he should not see death, and he was not found because God had taken him. Now, before he was taken, he was commended as having pleased God. And then in verse 39, we've already looked at verse 39, all these, though commended through their faith, did not receive what was promised. See, the problem is that these people in this church who were going to go back to Judaism would never receive a commendation, not condemnation, but a commendation from God. And you're going to go, God doesn't commend people. Oh, yeah, he does. In at least four places in the New Testament, this being one of them. When people hang on to God, serve him, seek to glorify him, God commends them. Two places where it says that. Number one, Matthew chapter 25, there's a parable. A king goes away. When he comes back, he calls to account his servants. And the ones who were faithful and did stuff with the finances he entrusted to them before he left, he says, well done, good and faithful slave. That is a commendation. In 1 Corinthians chapter 4, Paul says, you know, when we're serving the Lord, eventually we're serving the Lord properly and faithfully, God himself will praise us. And you're thinking, well, that's heresy. No, it's in the Bible. And the idea is that if we have come to Christ and we're hanging on to him, even when things get hard, even when our faith is challenged, at the end of it, God commends us for maintaining our faith in him and hanging on to him during this time. We don't let go of that. God doesn't actually forget when we endure in our faith, even when things are just royally difficult. And so these people who are found here in Hebrews chapter 11, God commends all of them because he revealed himself to them. We have the Bible now. So in many of the cases, they actually had special revelation. And so they actually saw that, and they went and did what he wanted, and they kept going. Even though it was hard, even though they couldn't see where they were going, they didn't know what was going to happen, they hung on to him. God commends them. And he'll do the same for us, guys. So I got laid off at Moody Bible Institute almost exactly a year ago. On November 8th, 1917. I'm old, but not quite that old. November 8th, 2017, I got called in and told I was laid off from Moody Bible Institute. Me and 33 of my colleagues, as one-third of the full-time faculty, got axed. It made sense. I was there 19 years, and so I was sort of at the upper end of the pay scale. It would make sense they would let me go to be able to free up some money. And I want you to know that I loved my job at Moody. Loved the students, loved the classes I taught, loved my colleagues, most of them. And it was really hard. It's in my sweet spot there. And not too long after I got laid off, I got royally depressed. Now, I've been royally depressed in the past, suicidally depressed, like 35 years ago. And it wasn't quite like that this time, but almost. And I began to question God's sovereignty and God's love. And I just want you to know, by the way, for what it's worth, I'm a Calvinist. Calvinists never question those two things. It was hard. But I just decided, you know, I know what Scripture says. I really believe God's in charge. I believe he's sovereign. I really also believe he's loving as well. And therefore, what had happened to me was part of his loving and sovereign design for my life. Now, frankly, it took a little while from that truth to go from here, from my head, to my heart. But it did make the migration. And God used it to really steady me. That is something that he may choose to commend me for in the future. It's not why I did it. But as I reflect upon this verse and what faith is, that it really does persevere when things are hard, maybe God will commend me for that in the future. That would be cool. I would love it if he would do that. But let me just say also, some of you, I'm guessing, are at the point where things are difficult for you. And it's harder to hang on to the Lord and believe he's actually in charge and that he loves you and that he's sovereign because of some crazy stuff that's going on in your life. Let me just assure you, those things about God are true. He is sovereign and loving, and you got to hang on to him. And if you do, he'll reward you for that. He does not forget. When we stay close to him and lean into him, when things around us are falling apart and bombs are dropping around us, he doesn't forget that. He'll reward us and bless us for those things. And so we keep hanging on, even though it's hard. The last point, last component of saving, persevering faith is that it knows God's power. By faith, it says, we understand. Notice what faith does here. Faith gives understanding. We understand that the universe was created by the Word of God. Now, how do we know that? We couldn't see that. We didn't know that happened, but Scripture says that, and there's proof and evidence of that, not only in Scripture, because Scripture says it. By the way, when Scripture says it, that settles it. Can I have an amen, please? When Scripture says it, that settles it. And so we can see in Scripture, there's proof that God has created everything, but we can see it also out there in creation as well. And so by faith it is, we understand, notice what faith does, that the universe was created by the Word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things that are visible. That is, God created everything out of nothing. And as we look at creation, there's a ton of stuff that we can know about God. And generically, we might know about his power and his greatness and his kindness and his orderliness. But there's other things as well. A little while ago, I came across an article, because a friend told me about it, published by the Institute for Creation Research, talking about how in creation, now apart from the Word, although I just want to say it again, the Word is the supreme, binding, authoritative revelation of God. Okay, you guys have heard me say that, right? But there's things we can know about God in creation. And I thought, well, there's not a lot we can know about God in creation. Well, there's more than you think, more than I thought. So in this article, they write about how in creation, you can see evidence of a Trinity. I thought, no, you can't. Yeah. This is what the guy wrote. And this is anonymous. I don't know who wrote it. Staff writer. He wrote, the created universe is actually a tri-universe of space, matter, and time, each permeating and representing the whole. However, the universe is not partly composed of space, partly of matter, and partly of time, like, for example, the three sides of a triangle. A trinity is not a trio or a triad, but a triunity, with each part comprising the whole, yet all three required to make the whole. Thus, the universe is all space, all time, and all matter, including energy as a form of matter. In fact, many scientists speak of it as the space-time-matter continuum. Furthermore, note the parallels between the divine Trinity and the tri-universe in terms of the characteristics of its three components. Space is the invisible, omnipresent background of everything in the universe. Matter reveals the reality of the universe. Time makes the universe understandable in the events occurring in it. Note that exactly the same sentence will apply if the words Father, Son, and Holy Spirit replace the words space, matter, and time. It helps if you're a physicist to understand this, I think. But I'm going to keep reading. Similarly, time, just time by itself, just time, is future, present, and past. It's all one. It's time. But there are three distinct parts for time. There's future, there's the present, and there's the past. Triunity. He goes on to say, the future is the unseen source of time, manifest moment by moment in the present and understood in the past. Again, substitute Father, Son, and Spirit. Thus, the physical universe is a great trinity of trinities, with the interrelationships of each element modeling the relationships of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Now, if you understood anything that I just read, and I'm not a physicist, you know, I almost didn't pass algebra in the ninth grade, so I'm not a physicist, I don't know that stuff, But I sort of get some of this. And when you heard that, my guess is most all of you are going to go, yeah. Do you know why you say yeah? It's because you have the lens of faith that enables you to see that that's true. And so you look out there in creation, that's the proof of God, and your faith connects with seeing and understanding that. That's how our faith works. So what does all this mean to us? A couple of things here I just want to say by way of conclusion. First, my guess is some of you are at a point in your life right now where things are crazy and hard, and you sort of go, you know, I don't really know if I believe this Christianity stuff. And I'm thinking maybe I'm going to go do something else, or I'm going to quit going to church, or I'm going to quit reading my Bible. It just doesn't work for me anymore. I mean, how many times have I heard that? Let me just say this. When you leave Jesus, there ain't nowhere else to go. There's nowhere else to go. Colossians say he created everything and the whole universe hangs together, but I think I'll leave him for Joseph Smith. Really? Why would you do that? You hang on to Jesus because there's great stuff coming, and you ask him to help you understand that that stuff is coming. You lean into your Christian friends. You lean into the Lord. You lean into your pastors. You lean into the Word of God. And don't let go of Jesus. In addition, God honors those who never give up in spite of the troubles they have, just like the heroes of Hebrews chapter 11. Like I said, when they left their thing, it was hard for them. The next time you feel discouraged, read Hebrews 11 and pray that God will help you to persevere in your relationship with him. And as we've already said, abandoning Christ and the new covenant that he's established is an incomparable folly. Why would we want to do that? Hang on to him. True saving faith hangs on to him and is blessed in the process and in the end. Let's pray. So, Father, I pray that you might strengthen our faith, especially those who have been roughed up by life and maybe are thinking that there isn't really, in Scripture or in Christianity, what's worth living for or depending on. Father, would you strengthen their faith? And for those of us who already know you as Savior, when things go crazy for us, Father, help us to lean into you more. Help us to lean into our Christian friends. Help us to do whatever it takes so that we don't walk away from you. Because that's subtle and it can happen. Father, how we need your help. In Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people said,
Amen. Amen.